So we know that populism is a very kind of researched area. It has been for quite some time, already longer than a lot of people are willing to admit, probably. And there's still a lot of different ways to think about populism. So the purpose of this very short kind of intervention or video is to talk very specifically and to get some insights into the kind of political strategic approach. So the first question would be obviously then, what is for you the political strategic approach, or what is the definition of that?
So the core of this political strategic approach is that it tries to focus on agency, on behavior, on what populists do. And it is in many ways very political science oriented because it sees populist actors, and especially populist leaders, as interested in gaining and exercising power. And so it looks at it from that perspective. And so it emphasizes the intersection of two factors. One is the type of leadership. And there I stress that populists are very personalistic leaders, big men who are full of themselves, who are headstrong, who think that, the typical idea, vox populi, the voice of the people, is the vox Dei, the voice of the Lord, and the populist leader speaks for them. The people cannot speak for themselves, and so it's the populist who incarnates and embodies the will of the people and who therefore has the right and the duty to do whatever they see fit as that embodiment of the people. And so these are people who are very full of themselves, to say it informally, who use personalistic strategies, for example, who surround themselves with family members like Donald Trump, with personal cronies, who are not much into organization institutions because those are constraints, those are limits on these personalistic leaders. So that's the one dimension, personalistic leadership. Now, personalistic leadership can come in different ways. There have been clientelistic leaders, there have been patrimonial leaders. What is the other core feature of this political strategic definition of populism is that these personalistic leaders try to win support through direct connections, direct contact with heterogeneous followers, large numbers of individuals. They try to mobilize numbers. They try to organize, win over the majority. They use votes, they use opinion polls. There are different strategies. One could use what I call special weight in that article, economic resources, military coercion. Populists essentially mobilize large numbers of people, and they do so in a quasi-direct way. They try to pretend that they have direct connections to these followers. Think, for example, of Hugo Chavez and his interminable television shows where people for hours were glued to Hugo Chavez, and it was like Hugo Chavez coming to their house and talking to them directly. And so once again, there is this direct contact that is not well organized, that's not institutionalized. These populist movements, they are informal, they are amorphous. They are, for that reason, kind of fickle and precarious because there isn't the discipline of organized party membership. Essentially, these people are followers of the big charismatic leader. And so the intersection of those two factors, personalistic leadership and direct connection to the followers through this charismatic reaching out to people rather than organization, that's the core of this political strategic definition. And the basic point is populist leaders do this in order to win power through elections and then to exercise power, always invoking their mass following, invoking opinion polls, invoking elections. Hugo Chavez in his 14 years of power held like 14 elections and plebiscites, constantly showing I have mass support. Fujimori in Peru, when he did his self-coup and overthrew democracy, people said, oh, how can you do this? And he said, I have 82% approval. Leave me alone. The people speak through me. And so that is, I think, the core of populism.
So if we think of populism as a strategy in this regard, what are some of the particular advantages of looking at the concept in this particular way?
So first of all, what you see is a recognition of the crucial importance of populist leadership. Because you see that virtually every populist movement, populist sentiment has a leader, revolves around a leader. You have some exceptions like the Tea Party that essentially looks for and searches for a leader, and Sarah Palin couldn't do it, so Trump kind of could take it over. But virtually all populist movements revolve around a leader. And the leader is in many ways the main agent. When you look at other definitions, for example, look at the Cass Mudde definition that defines populism as the discourse, the ideology that pits the pure, honest people against the corrupt elite. That doesn't get at the core of populism, because the people can't act. The people are not actors. They immediately delegate their agency to a leader, and it's the leader who acts. And you see that, especially nowadays, that a whole bunch of populist movements have won government power. So the political strategic definition focuses exactly on that, how populism is used and is the quest for power. And then it also tells you about the exercise for power. So that political strategic definition, you see how they try to come to power, not essentially by mobilizing masses of people. When they win the government, they act in very personalistic ways. For example, they very often have close coterie of cronies with whom they fill, like Trump, Ivanka Trump and Jared Kushner, right? And family members. And then you also see what they do. They constantly try to mobilize and demonstrate their support, since personalistic leaders want to reaffirm and enhance their personalistic agency. They try to push aside checks and balances. They try to weaken and undermine constraining institutions. They try to take over independent institutions. And so from the political strategic definition, you get kind of heuristic ideas about what these populist leaders do. And I think that is important. And I think it is a big advantage over the Cass Mudde definition, which essentially, the Cass Mudde definition is essentially bilateral, the people versus the elite. But the people can't act, the people don't act. And the Cass Mudde definition depicts this as kind of a base participatory democratic movement. You know, the people finally take charge. That's the rhetoric. The reality is that nowhere the people take charge, because the people cannot take charge. The people immediately delegate their agency to the leader. The leader claims to have this predominant position because they automatically embody the people, but it's the leader who acts, and the leader doesn't show up in the Cass Mudde definition. How, you know, so the core of what happens in populism is that allegedly the people are empowered, but what in another piece I call the populist twist, in fact, the people are not empowered. It's the leader who empowers him or herself, who claims to speak for the people, who just claims kind of identity representation. Like Chavez said, Chavez is the people and the people is Chavez. And so Chavez acted however he wanted to, and he did whatever he wanted to do, claiming that it was the people. The people had no idea. The people were not involved. It was Chavez making all the decisions. And that gets lost in the ideological discourse definition that is not the core. The core of populism is leadership. And these big people claiming that they can automatically act and speak on behalf of the people.
So if we then look at the leadership and we focus on the leadership, some in the literature would argue that the strategic approach puts too much emphasis on the leadership, because we also see populism amongst parties, amongst governments, and some would even argue within individuals. People can be populist more or less than others. So is there a way to kind of counter that particular argument within the strategic approach?
Well, what you see is this, I mean, when you have populist governments, it's a government that revolves around a leader. When you have populist parties, it's a party that revolves around a leader. You don't have a populist party that doesn't have a leader. Some leaders create parties that, especially when these parties are out of power, can achieve some level of solidity and stability. You know, let's say like APRA in Peru, the American Popular Revolutionary Alliance, they were a populist party revolving around one big leader. They were out of power for decades. And so they kind of created some kind of firmness. So you see Peronism in Argentina, but they are created by a big leader. They revolve around a big leader. And in many cases, when the big leader dies or whatever happens to them, these parties fall apart. Like, you know, the Ecuadorian party that revolved around José María Velasco Ibarra. And so, yes, there can be parties and yes, there can be governments that you could call populist, but because they revolve around a leader.
So related to that, some would then also argue or criticize the strategic approach because it has difficulty kind of generalizing beyond the Latin American context to more, let's say, advanced democratic settings, because there the leadership is perhaps less important than, let's say, the parties or the coalitions.
Is it? I mean, when you think, you know, think of like the first populist who won chief executive office in a Western European country was Silvio Berlusconi. Mm-hmm. And he created the party. The party revolved around him. Now that Berlusconi is getting old, his party is kind of falling apart. It's not that this, you know, he dominated Italian politics for about 15, 20 years, but he didn't create a party that has a certain firmness. You know, think of another populist in Slovakia, Vladimir Mečiar. He created a party and then he fell from power after 4 years in office and the party kind of shriveled up and shrank away, whatever. So people say, oh, but there's Viktor Orban, and Orban is in some sense a strange case because that party existed and Orban existed before he became populist. Now that party seems to be pretty firmly organized, whatever, who knows? I mean, assume the guy dies in a helicopter accident, let's see what happens. Whether that party actually has the firmness to persist or roof falls apart. And so I don't think that you see, you know, many parties. I mean, think of like Austria and Jörg Haider. When Haider crashed his car, that party took a significant hit. It ended up surviving and coming back and whatever, but it divided and all that. And so I think that the focus on leadership applies even to European countries. And it's also, I mean, the interesting thing is, you know, when we think about definitions and concepts, and are they valid, are they not? It's always a relative assessment because, mm-hmm. you know, the world is complex. No definition covers every single case. It's just, you know, there are a couple of kind of borderline cases and whatever. But what's interesting is the Cass Mudder, Kirk Hawkins approaches and definitions. They don't have leadership in their definition as such. But I mean, like Kirk Hawkins, how did he start out? Coding the speeches of leaders. It didn't code this, you know, the sentiments of people. And so you see, even in definitions that officially don't have leadership in the title, you see that is actually what even they think populism evolves around, because when they come, they code leaders. And interesting, when they code leaders, there are a whole bunch of cases that approach misses, that area experts think that Fujimori is a populist, that Uribe is a populist in Colombia, that the Kirchners were populists in Argentina, but they get very low scores in that. Whereas the political strategic approach looks at what these people did, not only what they say, but You know, were they big personalistic leaders? Did they try to win this mass support by direct connections to people, TV, Twitter, having these meetings like Uribe had these councils that he went all over the place, Fujimori helicoptered around the whole country? You see from their behavior, and I think the behavior is more indicative of what populism is and what populist leaders do than the rhetoric and the ideology and the discourse.
So would you then classify Donald Trump within that broader spectrum of—
Absolutely. Typical populist. And Donald Trump is such a typical populist. You know, you see that across ideology, across development level, across political system. I mean, he acts in many ways quite similar to Chavez, insulting people, attacking people, being an outrage. I mean, you see so many of the behavior is quite the same. Trying to undermine— Trump doesn't get very far because the United States has firm checks and balances. There is a strong opposition. There is a democratic civil society. But you see Trump, I mean, he would love to be the next Chavez.
Right, and that's something that you write about in your latest article, right? The Perspectives on Politics article, where you kind of discuss how populism, or to what extent populism, threatens or not democracy. So I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit specifically related to the American case, even though the article discusses many other cases.
Yes.
Very specifically to the United States and to Trump even more specifically. What is the relationship there between populism and democracy? How do these two interact? Is Trump a danger for democracy?
So the starting point is that I agree with a lot of the concerned observers that populism in principle poses a threat to democracy. Populists want to enhance their power, and that means they want to weaken, undermine, you know, if possible, strangle liberal democracy. But they can only succeed under certain conditions. And so what I do in that article is I look at a large number of populist chief executives, and I find out that only about a quarter of them actually succeeded in doing serious damage to democracy, because there are certain conditions. There are institutional conditions. You know, populists try to undermine institutions, so the stronger the institutions, the harder a time they have. Mm-hmm. Populists attack institutions based on their mass support. So the more, the broader and the more fervent mass support they have, the more successful they can be. And so when you analyze cases from Europe and Latin America, you see that those two things, weak institutions and strong support for populism, only prevail in about a quarter of the cases. You know, for example, interestingly, for populist leaders, often a serious crisis that they find can be an opportunity, because if they are the saviors of the people and they prove their charisma and only they can do it, they get mass support. Like Latin American populists who came to office under hyperinflation. When they ended hyperinflation, they got 60, 70, 80% support. With that steamroller of support, you can do serious damage to democracy. Now look at Trump from that perspective. Donald Trump is elected as a populist, a typical populist, in a political system that to the present day has pretty strong institutions. Checks and balances are pretty firm. Even the Supreme Court recently has told Donald Trump, you're not gonna get, you know, they have a Republican majority in the Supreme Court, and they say, no, sir. The Constitution, all the anti-democratic populists want to change, undo, overhaul the Constitution. Doing a new constitutional convention in the US is like, you know, totally unimaginable. So firm institutions, strong institutions, one big problem for Donald Trump. Second, he doesn't have mass support. He has never reached majority approval, majority support. And so, and one reason is when he came to office, contrary to what he tried to tell people, there wasn't a massive crisis. And so Donald Trump could never win the 60, 70, 80% of mass approval. I mean, Donald Trump wasn't even elected with a popular majority. He, in the popular vote, he lost the election. And so he doesn't have the massive support, and he faces firm institutional framework. And therefore, I conclude that Donald Trump wants to do a lot of damage. He has done some damage in terms of civility, of discourse, of norms, and whatever. But Donald Trump is not going to get away with any serious attack on serious damage to US democracy, even if he were reelected in November.
So would it be then fair to say, to conclude, that the success of the populist leader, no matter how populist he is, that it very much depends on the context within which
Absolutely.
He or she operates?
It depends on the context. It also depends to some extent on the agency. So there are populist leaders who are just, you know, make a ton of mistakes. You know, Fernando Collor in Brazil, or Bucaram in Ecuador, he was so massively corrupt that after 6 months they threw him out. So there can be just mistakes, you know, agency that doesn't work. But a lot of it depends, as you say, on the conditions. How strong is the institutional framework? And what are the preconditions for a populist to gain this massive support? And when you say the success of a populist, I mean the success of a populist, they want to weaken and undermine democracy. As I say, to end with a paradox in that article that you mentioned, Donald Trump inadvertently has stimulated mass mobilization against him. There are a ton, like you saw in the 2018 midterm elections in the US, a ton of candidates came forward and said, I want to run against this guy and his cronies. You know, electoral registration is up. Electoral participation in the midterm election of 2018 was way higher than it had been for 100 years in the United States because of Donald Trump, and it was against him. It gave him a defeat. And so when you think about Donald Trump, everybody says, oh, Donald Trump is such a threat to democracy. In some strange way, because he's such an awful person, he has helped to revive, to rejuvenate American democracy, because so many people dislike the guy. And in the United States, when you dislike the guy, you don't go into the streets and make mass contention and protest, whatever. You go through the institutions, through the electoral arena, you run as candidates, you go out and register, and you vote. And you vote him down. And so Donald Trump, in some sense, you know, paradoxically speaking, might have given a positive boost to US democracy.
I think that's a very nice way of wrapping up the summary of the article. And I thank you very much for
Good. The Okay, thank you.